Back in 2020 at 19 years old, I just entered university and I was very excited to finally learn advanced C++. You know, that weird cryptic things that only C++ gods know about. By that point, I was already learning C++ for like 5 years, and I got stuck at level 4 out of 5 in C++ learning. So I was really excited to finally learn the difficult things. I talked to a guy 1 year older than me about the C++ course, also telling him that I already know some C++, so I'm ready for any challenge. His reply was short. No. Bro, you have no idea what you are up against. It's extremely hard, forget anything you think you know. It might sound scary, but that's what I wanted. I wanted to finally reach level 5 of C++ learning. So I entered the class very excited for what was about to come, only to find out that we were actually only learning level 3 C++. In other words, I was way past their class. But here is the interesting thing. Most people think that this is advanced C++, when in fact, it is only scratching the surface. So let's find out where you are right now, and more importantly, if it is worth learning all the way to level 5, because I want to get in depth about advanced C++ things, give weird examples, explain how the language got there, what you should do, and where you can learn all of these things. Starting with level 1, absolute beginner. This is where you just start C++. You don't know yet what a compiler is, and you tell people that you installed C++ on your computer. Errors are your worst enemies, and adding programming skills on your CV at this point is punishable by death penalty. All you can do right now is print hello world to the console, and maybe make a very simple calculator. At least you are not a computer science weirdo. But don't worry, all of that is about to change. With a little practice, you will get to level 2. The basics. Technically, you are still a beginner. Errors are still your worst enemies, and you still should be executed for adding C++ skills on your CV. But at least you know some basics, like functions. And you can contribute to society by making some very simple programs, like this one. And this level actually goes to more than just functions. You also know what a class is, what memory allocation is, and maybe even some very basic things from the C++ standard. By this point, you probably have also made up your mind if you want to pursue a programming career. And if so, congratulations! Women will automatically avoid you from now on, and people won't understand your programming memes. But at least you can expect to make good money while making projects that contribute to society. Now we get to level 3, and I called it advanced in quotes. Level 3 is very interesting, because most people that get here think that they know advanced C++, and I was one of them. At this level, besides knowing how to use common standard library features, like unique pointers and various algorithms, you not only know how polymorphism works, but all the strange C++ rules, like downcasting, upcasting, diamond inheritance, the rule of 3, and it's also where most basic C++ interview questions will revolve around. The reason most people stop here is that you don't really find more advanced information in 99% of all courses out there, so they just assume that's about it with C++. In reality, you barely scratch the surface of C++, and I would not even hire you as a C++ intern. Just kidding, but seriously, we have just started. And once you realize how little you know, you start learning to get to level 4, real advanced C++. This is when things start to become interesting. You see, C++ is an old language that evolved with time. Many language additions were not only the latest invented, but they had to implement them without breaking old features. The result is something working, but that isn't as good as it could be. Templates are a perfect example. You see, generic programming became something very important, and C was really lacking in that department. So C++ added templates to accommodate for it. And they were supposed to be something very simple. They just allow you to remake the same implementation for different types. After some time, however, people realized that templates are much more powerful than they initially thought. Let's say you want to implement this templated function to only work on float or double, and only that. Here is what we can do. We first create this templated struct, and we add a specialization for it. So we have a member here, that's only present if we provide a float or a double. Finally, we use this template thing when implementing our function. If we try to call this function with an int, it will fail. This is because we try to access this type member here, but it doesn't exist for ints, it only exists for floats. This is called sphinae, and we are just getting started. We also have CRTP, variety templates, and the fact that templates are actually Turing complete, meaning that you can write any computer program using only templates. The funny thing is that all of these things were found by mistake, and the C++ standard fully embraced it and implemented helpers for doing sphinae and other things. The problem, however, is that if you want to do something more complex with templates, things are very complex. One time, I got to this very weird problem, where I have to use this template keyword here to tell C++ that this method is templated, otherwise it won't compile, and I guarantee that 99% of users will never see this weird problem. Now let's compare this with a new language like Zig. In Zig, you can just write normal code that runs at compile time. So basically, Zig doesn't have templates. You can just write normal code instead. So if you want to have a loop, you don't need to use weird recursion. You can just write a very simple for loop. Or instead of sphinae, you can just make a simple if. C++ is also moving in this direction though, so props to them, but very slowly. Let me finally give you an example of level 4 C++ knowledge. Let's say you want to remove all the elements that are smaller than 10 from this vector. You can use remove if and a lambda. And if you thought this is correct, you are wrong. You actually have to call erase. Remove if doesn't actually remove any element. Truly spectacular language. Now here I provide a lambda. Basically a function to specify what elements I want to remove. What if I told you I can rewrite it like this, without any lambda? This is a struct with operator overloading to in the end become equivalent to this lambda. And I implemented it for various other operators, and it was inspired by a boost feature that implements even more crazy features than I did. This is the code, but I'll return later to it. Now, you might expect me to tell you that I'm a level 5 C++ god, but I'm actually not. And I'm going to explain you why I don't think it's worth getting to level 5, and what you should do instead. Level 5 guru means you know almost all the strange things about the language, about the standard library, and also weird language behaviors. And I want you to get a feeling of what that means. You can, for example, read an entire file in one line with this syntax, or using algorithms, you can actually add a flag to use the multi-threaded version of the algorithm. But if you knew that already, you are only level 4. There are way more obscure things than that. Like for example, there are some features that allow you to format time. Or maybe you have seen these weird string literals. Well, you can overload and create your own custom string literals in C++. But while I show some more weird C++ quotes, I want to talk about some serious stuff. Why I don't recommend focusing on all of these very advanced things, and what you should do instead. You have to understand that C++ had a goal of implementing generic programming, while keeping the language performant. And they 100% managed to do this. But they were also kind of the first to do this. So it's not very nice to use. Let's look at an example. This is a reference. This is an R-value reference. You can think of it as a reference of a temporary value. So when you return a vector, it will be returned as a temporary value. And it will be then constructed using a move constructor to steal the data, skipping unnecessary memory allocation. What I described here is not very hard so far. But things become harder and harder. This is a forwarding reference. Same syntax as an R-value reference, but in a template. The C++ committee considered making it like this, to look different, but that was too goofy. A forwarding reference can be both a normal reference or an R-value reference, depending on the context. But then you need to also use this forward thing here when passing it, otherwise it will decay. And there are some things about that as well, so if you are confused by this, that's the point. But let's keep going, because what I have described so far is still something that most people know. Let's imagine you want to implement a vector. This is a templated thing, so it has to work with anything that you pass to it, no matter if it is a simple type or a type that allocates data. So you need to be careful to correctly allocate the data, construct the class, and call the destructor. Now here is the big problem. Unless you are a level 5 C++ god, there is no way you can guarantee that this code is correct. C++ is a statically typed language. You have compile errors, and then you can check your code to test if it is good. And you are done. But for something like this, how can you guarantee that you move the data types right, no matter what weird thing you pass? Like this thing. Guess what? It's wrong. This is the correct version. I even implemented unit tests, and every time I revisit this repo, I find bugs inside, even though I was 100% sure I implemented it correctly. And then I made a video about it, and people still found problems with it. Now, they will say that this is a skill issue, and that I need to learn C++. But let's think critically for a second. I've been learning C++ for 10 years. I can make a multiplayer Minecraft from scratch, with multiple threads, but I can't correctly implement the simplest data structure? I'm not joking when I say that I can guarantee that my lock-free multi-threaded server implementation that doesn't need mutexes for synchronization is correct and safe, and that I don't leak memory on the CPU or the GPU, but I can't guarantee that this vector implementation is correct. Like, this thing is simply nasty, and the reason the standard library code is so complex is because it has to be for it to be correct. This is the standard vector implementation. 4000 lines of code for the simplest data structure possible. Remember this code that I showed earlier? Well, tell me if you can understand what I'm doing here. And remember that all of this stuff that most people won't be able to understand is only to implement this simple thing. The more you code, the more you'll realize that generic code is overrated, and you can just use already existing C++ features for it, and maybe constexpr if. It's way better to keep your code simple. To put it differently, you should learn about advanced C++ features if that is your language. But your code shouldn't look like it is a standard library implementation, full of templates, weird generic programming, and hard to understand code that provides very little help. Remember, I can't guarantee that this simple vector is correct. So how can you expect writing an entire program in this manner will produce bug-free code? Just write your code simple and easy to debug step by step. That's also why I don't look into C++ 20 features, even though they are probably cool. I won't use any of them. I already have everything I need. This is the code for my game, and you can see that most of it just uses plain, simple, readable C++ code. though some extra compile time features would be nice. So, what does that mean for you? Well, you should learn how C++ works, and I will give some good links in the description, like this playlist from Jason Turner. But once you get to advanced levels, it's better that you spend most of your time making big projects, like a C++ game. So I have a video just for that, and also I just launched an OpenGL course if you struggle placing your first triangle on the screen. And because you are still the end, I have a discount code that works only for a month after releasing this video. So make sure you use it if you are interested in the course. All links in the description. See you!